KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF from Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's 2:30 p.m., and it's time now for Education Today. Stay with us.
From the studios of KPFA in Berkeley, this is Education Today. Good afternoon and welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. We're going to be discussing education in the news today, discussing both disturbing factors and some positive things people are doing about them. We've spent quite a bit of time on this program in the past laying out the systematic way that various laws and regulations seem to be making things difficult for urban schools. Today we're going to be discussing two examples of research and action by individuals who are trying to either change or get around these challenges. And then we're going to be taking your calls and hearing your responses around education issues. As everyone knows, school will be back in session very soon. One parent this morning told me she couldn't wait. And that may be the case for a lot of youngsters too, but there are some problems which cause youngsters sometimes not to want to go back to school. And one of them sometimes, if you've listened to this program on a regular basis, you'll know that one of them is the lack of permanent, diverse, and effective teachers in urban schools. Sometimes school systems open the first day of school with as many as 50 or 100 unfilled positions. And this is not through any fault of their own, oftentimes. Oftentimes they have hired, they have interviewed, they've done everything they can to get teachers in the classroom, but sometimes teachers resign just a week or so before school, and because of the credential requirements, it's very difficult for people to get in. So we are going to be discussing this issue and some action that that teachers and parents and others in Oakland have been taking about it. We'll also spend a little bit of time later on talking about new results out about the exit exam and some research on resiliency of youth who have, negative experiences, what causes them to be able to bounce back, and what schools can do differently to make a larger portion of students who have difficulties in their environment be able to bounce back well. Now, first we're going to talk about the issue of teacher availability for urban schools. As we've pointed out on this program in the past, urban schools have a difficult time because they have a lot of turnover of teachers, and the people who find it most easy to get into the teaching field are more affluent, more white parts of the U.S. population. And those are often people who don't live in urban communities. And so if they go into teaching and get a job somewhere like Los Angeles or San Jose or Oakland, they may leave that job after a year or two when a job becomes available in the neighborhood or the community where they live. And this leaves urban students without teachers or with a kind of heavy turnover. And so at that point, the urban districts are forced to hire somebody else. And since the districts themselves don't get to decide the qualifications, they're all established by state regulation and credentials, there usually are not enough people to fill those positions. And often the districts have to take people who actually aren't that good at working with youngsters, but may be able to fulfill all the testing requirements. There was a group of people in Oakland who decided to do something about this. One of the originating groups was a task force that was part of Mayor Dellum's initiation into office. And they came up with the idea of doing a teacher recruitment summit in partnership with the mayor's office, the school district, and the teachers union. And that summit was held last weekend on Saturday. And one of the people who participated in it, a young man by the name of Brandon, actually heard about the summit on this program. And so I ran into him at the summit and asked if he would call in and talk with us both about this novel approach to dealing with the problem how he's feeling about teaching, and but then some of the challenges he's confronting also. So, Brandon, I hope we have you on the line. Welcome
right
to Education
here.
Today. Hi.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Nice talking with you. Glad. Thank you for joining us.
Okay.
So, what did motivate you to start thinking about teaching? Has this been something you've always thought you would be doing?
Yes and no. I've been thinking about it for a while. It's something that I learned that I could do and that I enjoyed years ago, so I learned that. But what led me there was just I've been thinking a lot seriously, critically about ways I could give back. You know, I didn't want to be part of the contingent that doesn't do anything but have voiced their criticisms. And I just want to think of ways I could directly give back to what I saw as a way to give directly back to what's going on in our community and society. And for me, that was to cut through all the red tape and the middlemen and be directly with the children, the future.
Fantastic. And where do you live?
I live in Oakland, but I grew up in Berkeley, so right on the Oakland-Berkeley border. But I'm a Berkeley boy, Berkeley-Oakland area, local
right.
product,
and
proud
can
to say.
Can you tell us something about your own educational background?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I've been lucky enough to, you know, through a strong family, I was able to go to St. Mary's College High School. But before that, I went through K through 8, public school, Berkeley, public school, loved it. Was able to go to St. Mary's High School. And from there, I was able to go to Hampton University in Virginia, which is a historically black college, which was one of the best decisions I made. I was lucky enough to go there and experience the East Coast. And then I was fortunate enough to come back here and go to law school in San Francisco at New College of California, and was able to experience that and got a chance to go to do international studies abroad in Greece and Egypt and had a wonderful time doing that. So I've done all that, and now I'm back to give back to Oakland.
Fantastic. So you attended this recruitment summit on Saturday, right? Can you tell us something about that?
I was lucky enough to be listening to your program a couple weeks ago. Had no idea it was going to come on, just doing some work and listening to KPFA. And so my message to everybody out there is if you can hear my voice, you can do it too, because I was listening to this program a couple of weeks ago and now I'm on it. So the bottom line is go for it. You can do it. And also I wanted to say, I did answer your question. I heard about this program luckily enough, through your program.
Great.
About the summit through your program.
Great. So what was the focus of the summit and how do you think it worked?
I don't know what the focus of the summit was, but what I got out of the summit was just being an average citizen, interested, you know, concerned citizen, was able to come down to City Hall, have access to teaching experts like yourself, have access to the mayor. Like I said, I'm just a regular guy, local product, local community person. And so that was really meaningful to me that, you know, we hear about, people talk about that a lot, but I was actually, the way that worked practically for me was I heard about your program, went down to City Hall Saturday, got myself up, and went down there and was able to have access to all that great information and, like I said, access to the mayor and all those services by people who knew what they were talking about.
That's great. And so are you proceeding to get into teaching yourself? Were you convinced and persuaded?
I am proceeding to get into teaching. I was lucky enough to actually be offered to actually meet someone and interview with them, and I was actually offered a position through going to the summit. So I was lucky enough to go to the summit. I was lucky enough to even meet someone and actually be offered a position, which all worked out great. But there comes in what I learned about now is how No Child Left Behind has affected my life, because the first thing I want to say is that if you're thinking about teaching, if you're even considering it or thinking about it, I would suggest you take the CBEST and the CSET exams. And the reason why I say that is because, speaking of what I was just talking about before, it affected me because I'm a law school graduate, I have taken the CBEST, but I have everything except for the CSET exams. And now I was in a position where I was going to be the only adult, the only African-American male full-time teacher on staff at a school in East Oakland, which we all know how important that is. And now I'm in a situation where, you know, sometimes teachers who would be best for the children don't get to be in the classrooms, you know, because, like you said, the standards that we have. I'm definitely going to go back and make sure I have all the standards that I need. And I suggest people who are interested, you know, are really serious about teaching and really serious about helping young people to do the same. But at the same time, where does that leave the 30 kids in East Oakland who may have a substitute now, may or may not have a teacher, you know, that whole thing. So
a lot of lessons from you, Brandon.
Definitely.
One, some help to people who might think about this field. There are two exams that you'll probably be required to pass, and you can find out about them either from credential programs in the area or on the website of the California Commission on Teacher Credentialing. The CBES is the California Basic Educational Skills Test, which Brandon has already taken and passed, and the CSET is a test, another test people are required to take, which is supposed to delve more into specific subject matter. So here we have a young man who is willing, able, and eager to teach youngsters in East Oakland. He has proceeded through a history major at college, has a BA in that. He has proceeded through law school. He has passed the first of the teacher exams, and he would be the only African-American male on a school in a school that has mostly African-American students, and yet he is not considered sufficiently qualified to teach fifth graders, and in preference, they will probably have a substitute.
Thanks, Mr. Bush.
And thank you, Brandon, for calling in. Bless you, too, and thanks for sharing that with us. I think it makes the whole situation very graphic. Both the opportunities and the desire of a lot of people to teach, and, you know, different ways people are trying to make that more accessible, like the summit, but also some of the remaining problems. Thank you. Thank you for calling.
On behalf of the whole community, thank you, Kitty.
Okay. Great. Bye-bye. Thanks. Bye. We have another caller with us now. Zinzi is a parent of a young person who goes to school in Oakland, and she was also at the summit, and I wanted to talk with her a little bit about her thoughts on teachers. You know, what are the most important qualities, and what does she think about the teaching situation? Zinzi, are you with us?
Yes, I am, Kitty.
Welcome to Education Today. And thank you for joining us. And you are the parent, I know, of at least one daughter. You have other children?
No, I have one daughter in the Oakland Public School System.
Fantastic. So do you feel like you've learned anything about, you know, teaching, what makes good teachers, any of that?
Well, I can say that I was raised with two parents that taught in the Oakland Public School System, and so I was intimately involved in education from a very early age, and my parents set their standards very high as far as their commitment to educating our children. And now that I'm at an age where I have a child in the Oakland Public School System, and I'm actually a community leader, I'm a pastor at Abundant Life Ministries here in Oakland with a lot of young people that are in this district as well, I can say that I learned a great deal, and for the most part, it's been very disheartening.
Really? Can you let me give out our telephone number, and I want to ask you about what was disheartening about it. You're listening to Education Today on KPFA 94.1 FM. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein, and we're continuing to talk with Zinzi, who is a parent in the Oakland schools, about her own experiences with teachers. But we'd like to invite you to call in also. We'll be taking your calls in a couple of minutes, and the telephone number at the studio is 510-848-4425. That's 848-4425. Thank you. So, Zinzi, what's the disheartening part?
Well, first, I'm committed to Oakland and seeing Oakland become a model city and making it better for the generations to come after us. And I just don't feel like I'm getting that, one, from the state and also from the district itself. I feel that my child has been failed in so many ways by teachers that were either too old and tired to invest in her the way that they needed to, or teachers that were young and inexperienced and weren't weren't given an opportunity to spread their wings before they got shut down by, to me, an antiquated system that has failed our children.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think people should be looking for as they look at teachers? And do you have any idea what process should be used to do the selection of people who are going to teach?
Well, I really think that we need to break the old mold and start developing a new system, because just as you've already said, and Brandon before me, there's so many qualified people that are being overlooked for reasons that, when you, in the grand scheme of things, don't make a whole lot of sense. And so I would really like to see a new standard set up where we have urban people educating urban children and giving them an opportunity to get the education they need as teachers and the training that they need, without expecting them to meet some unrealistic expectations for who they are in this community.
So you think there should be a little bit more cultural competence on the part of people who are looking at teachers to say there are a lot of people who can do a good job at this and people have a lot of different qualities. Let's respect all the different qualities people have instead of just looking for a more stereotyped vision of what a teacher should be.
Exactly. And I believe our children should be well-rounded. So I'm not saying that they should only be taught by people who grew up in an urban community, but I do feel that that is necessary for the child to be able to identify with its teacher so that they can feel like what they have achieved and accomplished, the student can also reach these types of goals and can have someone to look up to them, or to have someone to look up to that looks like them and grew up like them and has some of the same or at least similar values as the children have.
And did you find some of those people at the summit when I believe you attended, right? Did you see
Yes.
some of the people you think should be in teaching at the summit?
I did, but to tell you the truth, I didn't communicate with a wide variety of people that were at the summit, but what our mayor said to me was just right on point with what Oakland needs. And so if he can find more people to believe in Oakland the way that he does and to value Oakland the way that he does, then I believe we're going to be okay. I mean, I really believe in our mayor and in the development of a model city that we will be able to stand as a beacon for other cities around the country to be able to look to. I feel if he can get others to support him, more of us to support him, then we will be able to accomplish these goals.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for calling, Zinzi, and we really appreciate you being with us on Education Today. Before we take our calls, I just wanted to mention that if people are interested in teaching, I spent a lot of years teaching. It's the most wonderful job you could be in. The exciting thing about it to me was that it's never boring, and that's a very big priority for me as far as employment is concerned. And there's also, you know, the summers off and so on and so forth. And you are doing something profoundly important for young people. So if you are interested in the field, I'd really encourage you to take the steps to get in. There are sometimes internship programs where you can be employed and take your credential work at the same time. And as Brandon pointed out, one of the first steps you need to take, of course, is to have a bachelor's degree and to take this thing called the CBEST test. And then at least you can start substituting, and sometimes you can actually get into a full-time classroom. And I know the people from the summit are working on ways to help people through the process, both fees and so on and so forth. So thank you, too, for sharing that with us. And we do have a caller now, Aaron from Castro Valley. Welcome to Education Today.
How are you doing?
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing all right.
Great.
One thing, I think that education is defined by the problem one has to solve. And I think that black children don't have to solve the same type of problems that white children have to solve. Therefore, I think that black children are being educated for a different reason. And I think that black children should be going to school with each other to learn about how to solve black issues.
Mm-hmm. And what do you mean by that? What do you see as the different educational problems that black children are solving as opposed to white children?
Power, real power, and stopping people who use racism against them.
I see. So students should be in a school where they are learning something about what to do about people who use racism against them.
Correct. and learning their history so they can learn how to solve their own problems. And I think that's how intelligence is defined.
You know, I totally, absolutely, 100% agree with you. I think there is a huge problem. You know, sometimes when I bring up the importance of diversity in teaching, people will say, well, are you saying that a white teacher can't teach a black kid and a black teacher can't teach a white kid? I'm not saying that. I think that there are cases where people do great teaching across cultural, racial lines. But the fact is that if African-American children don't have at least a large number of African-American adults, they don't have anybody to model for them how you do deal with racism, which is real in the world. And I don't see, you know, as great and wonderful as a lot of white teachers are, it is hard to teach something you can't have an experience yourself, which is as deep and profound as that. So to me, I totally agree with you. I think that's the most important reason why we need a diverse teaching force. It's not just, you know, something for cosmetics or whatever. It's for that profound, important aspect of what the education of African-American kids need to be about. And I really appreciate your call. Are you in education? Have you thought about going into education?
I've thought about it. I'm thinking about getting into it, still talking it over with my better half.
Maybe you can do it together. Then you'll have those summer vacations off, huh?
Right.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for calling in.
All right. Have a nice day.
Thank you. We are at KPFA 94.1, and the call-in number to the studio is 510-848-4425. We'd love to take your calls and hear your comments on this subject of teaching or other issues you'd like to discuss about education. I wanted to bring up a couple other things that have happened in the last few weeks. One is that the results on the California exit exam came out, and it shows that a couple percentage points more students pass the exit exam this time. The improved pass rate is from 91% to 93% of the graduating class. And this has been touted by many as an indication that the exit exam is, in fact, the Chronicle headline says, push to raise scores on exit exam pays off in California. And so, you know, the argument is made that the exit exam is a good thing because higher rates of kids are passing. The problem, of course, is those who don't. And 91 to 93% is good, but that still leaves 7% of the kids not passing. They cannot get a diploma, although they have gone to school for 12 years until they pass or unless they pass. And that adds up to 29,691 California children who did go to school. So this is not kids who are cutting all the time. They went to school enough to get 12 years worth of credits, but they still are denied a diploma. And I think there are, you know, a lot of questions to raise about what that means and what impact it has on young people and whether it's really fair to them to put them in that situation. For youngsters who are in a vulnerable situation, either perhaps homeless, living in a group home, or whatever the difficulties that they may be having, there is some recent research which shows that the most important factors for those young people are not more paper and pencil tests, more test prep, more scripted curriculums, but actually things like caring relationships, meaningful participation, and so on. The research called resiliency research, which has been done over a period of time now about what is it that causes young people in vulnerable situations to be able to hang on, stay out of trouble, stay out of gangs, stay off of drugs, whatever it is that we're worried about them staying away from, indicates that things like caring relationships and meaningful participation are the most important factors. I listened to a very interesting presentation by Bonnie Bernard, who is with WestEd. That's an educational research organization on this subject. And I suggest that those who are interested in what makes a difference for vulnerable youngsters might want to look up the research on resiliency. Again, our call-in number is 848-4425, and we'd be interested to hear from you, your thoughts on education, teachers, exit exams, resiliency research, or whatever else you might want to talk with us about. I wanted to give a little bit more information for people who might be interested in going into the field of education. You may, if you have a bachelor's degree, you might be quite close to being able to get into teaching, and you might want to just check in with your local college about what the requirements are and where they how you might get the ones that you don't have yourself. There are a lot of requirements, more than there need to be, I think, but on the other hand, most, if you have a bachelor's degree, they are often things that are within your grasp. It's just, you know, it costs a little bit of money, takes some time to get through them all, but in general, they are within your grasp. I'd like to welcome G.S. from Berkeley to Education Today.
Very good. Thank you. Delighted to be with you.
Sure.
I'd like to recommend a book by George B. Leonard that was written in 1968 called Education and Ecstasy. It is all about what teaching is really for and how we might be able to make that a delight for everyone involved. And I'll just read three sentences from the one chapter, very short.
Thank you.
Number one, the human potential is infinitely greater than we have been led to believe. Number two, learning is sheer delight. And number three, learning itself is life's ultimate purpose.
Can you read the last one again?
Yes. The third paragraph is headed with this italicized sentence. Learning itself is life's ultimate purpose.
Wow. This is deep, profound.
Yeah, a lot of people believe that you incarnate as a soul, you incarnate into a body in order to learn more about reality.
Mm, wonderful.
And you learn as much as you can, and then you need to learn more, you just come back and try again.
Wonderful. Thank you for recommending that book. I would say, you know, some people think the thing to read is whatever's the most, you know, up-to-date, what was put out last month. But actually, in the field of education, some of the older books that were written during the period when the civil rights movement was very strong are actually much more interesting and, I would say, progressive and thought-provoking than some of the stuff
Absolutely.
That's being read now. Yes, so that's exactly. Education and Ecstasy is what he's recommending. A couple others written sort of during the same time. There's a book by David Tyack called The One Best System, which is a really good educational history about education in the United States. I actually wrote a book recently on that history called A Different View of Urban Schools. And there are some others, one called Schools as Sorters by a man called Paul Chapman. So all of those are interesting studies. Now we have with us, just for a 30-second conversation, Suraj from Oakland. Welcome to Education Today.
Hi, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I've been listening to it, and I was thinking that with the school and as far as the African and our African-American children, they seem to be focused on a lot of athletics and things like that, which is okay. But I think we need to really try to get our kids geared for more things like economics and sciences and, you know, get them away from that you can be a Hank Aaron or a Barry Bonds and that's going to do it, because it seems like they're all doing it at once. And I think if we change our numbers around and get them focused on the things that are basically in the social structure that will make them successful, and then also they can pass that on to the young ones, to the older generation, and start to change things economically.
Thank you. Really good point. I'm sorry to cut you off, but we're just about to end the program, but thank you. I think it's a good point. Often young people do in school the things that are pleasant to do, and a lot of times kids are getting more validation for sports and music than they are in the classroom because of some of the factors we talked about. But we certainly want everybody to be well-rounded and have economic potential, intellectual potential, sports potential, and all those things. So thank you for your thoughts on that. Our next program airs the second Friday of the month in September. And if you have questions regarding today's program, you could email us at educatetoday@earthlink.net. The producer for Education Today is Kevin Cartwright, and I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. We hope to talk with you again in a couple of weeks, and thank you for listening to Education Today.
Thank you.